Welcome back. Game theory, dominant strategy, and Nash equilibrium. All right, so we're going to determine or learn how to determine whether a firm has a dominant strategy, how to find a Nash equilibrium if there is one, and how things change if the game is going to be played more than one single time. So let's get to it. All right, so the first thing is, what is a dominant strategy? Dominant strategy is the player's best action regardless of the action taken by the other player. Not all games have a dominant strategy. Okay, so this is where one player, or both, they can both have one too, player has a best action regardless of what the other firm chooses to do. So we have firm one and firm two. So what we need to do to figure out if we have a dominant strategy, we're gonna look at this. So firm two, they can choose high or low, firm one can choose high or low. So let's look at it this way. If firm two decides to make high output, okay, what's the outcome going to be for firm one? Well, if firm one also does high output, let's make this red for firm one, then their payoff will be 15. If they do low, their payoff will be 25. Okay, so if firm two, this is how you do this. You're going to look vertically for firm one. So firm two does high, firm one does high, they get 15. Firm one does low, they get 25. 25 is better than 15, so far, that's a mark in the box for low. If, on the other hand, firm two does the low strategy, what's gonna happen? Well, if they do low, firm one does high, they get zero as their payoff. If firm one does low, though, their payoff would be 5. Again, 5 is greater than 0, just like 25 is greater than 15. So what that means is that for firm one, they have a dominant strategy, and it is to do low output. Because either way, regardless of what firm two does, whether firm two does high or whether firm two does low, firm one does better either way by taking the low output. So they have a dominant strategy. We could do this the other way around. It's the same number, so it will work the same exact way. But if we wanted to find out whether firm two has a dominant strategy, we would essentially do the same exact thing. So real quick, let me just show you, because now you're going to be looking horizontally in this case. So we would look at firm one. If firm one does high, we're going to compare now horizontally firm two. If firm two does high, let me get a different color so we know that whose actions we're looking at. If firm two does high, they're going to have 15 as their payment. If they do low, their payment will be 25. So far, that's a mark in favor of low, because low 25 is better than 15. If firm one, on the other hand, does the low output, firm two will earn 0 if they do high output, and they'll earn 5 if they do low output. Again, both of these, 25 is greater than 15, 5 is greater than 0. So firm two has a dominant strategy to also engage in low output. So again, the trick of this is making sure that you know when you're looking vertically and when you're looking horizontally for which firm. So this is firm two. We say they have a low, their dominant strategy is to go low. Okay, rewatch it if you need to, hopefully it'll help. All right, we also have something known as a Nash equilibrium. All right, this is named after John Nash, guy from A Beautiful Mind, mathematician, Nobel Prize winner. This is what he won his Nobel Prize for, in fact, was for coming up with this concept. This is a non-cooperative equilibrium, okay, is the other name for this. Usually the AP test, though, you'll see Nash equilibrium. You could see non-cooperative, though, I suppose. This is the result when each player in a game chooses the action that maximizes his or her payoff given the actions of the other players. Okay, so dominant strategy, remember, it didn't matter to you what the other player did. That was your best strategy, regardless of which one they chose. Nash equilibrium, however, is not that way. Nash equilibrium is when a player chooses their best action based specifically on what the other player is going to do. So this one might be a little bit more involved to figure out. So in this case, let's look at firm A, okay? We want to see if firm A has a dominant strategy. That's where we're going to start. Always start with looking at the dominant strategy first. That's how you'll find your Nash equilibrium if one exists. Does firm A have a dominant strategy? Well, if firm B invests, firm A can earn 9 if they invest or 7 if they don't invest. So far that's telling us firm A wants to invest. However, if firm B doesn't invest, firm A would earn 8 by investing and 11 by not investing. So what's happening here is, depending on what B does, it'll change what A should do. So A does not have a dominant strategy. So we're going to put an X here. A, no dominant strategy. So we don't know what A should do yet. Okay, well, what about B? Does B have a dominant strategy? All right, if firm A invests, firm B can either earn 10 by investing or 15 by not investing. So far we'd say that they want to not invest. If firm A doesn't invest, but B does, they would earn negative 10, but they would earn 11 if they also don't invest. So now what we're seeing here is that firm B is better off either way by not investing, because 15 is greater than 10 and 11 is greater than negative 10. So we know that firm B has a dominant strategy, and that dominant strategy is to not invest. So firm B is not going to invest. We don't know what firm A is going to do yet. But now this is where we think about it, because now we know what firm B is going to do. Guess what? These two boxes don't matter anymore to firm A, because they know firm B is not going to invest. Firm B is not going to invest. So now firm A just has to look and decide, well, what's better then? If we know firm B is not investing, if firm A chooses to invest, they'll earn 8. If firm B chooses not to invest, they'll earn 11. 11 is bigger than 8, so firm A is going to choose not to invest as well. And this, 11, 11, that's going to be our Nash equilibrium. Okay, so firm B, this is their dominant strategy. That's me writing DS for dominant strategy. Firm A does not have a dominant strategy, but there is a Nash equilibrium that's going to take place with neither investing, both earning 11, because firm A knows that B has that dominant strategy. So firm A will not invest, because that is their best option when firm B does not invest. So given the action of firm B, that's going to be the best action, and no player has a incentive to change their strategy. All right, just a couple other things to know about a Nash equilibrium. It can exist when there's no dominant strategy. That might be a little bit more complex version I can show you in class, but typically the AP test is going to do just like what we just did just now. No individual or firm has an incentive to change his or her action. Again, because B has a dominant strategy, so that's what they're going to do no matter what. And then once you know that they have that dominant strategy, you figure out what's best for you, and you have found your Nash equilibrium. You're in equilibrium because there's no incentive for anybody to change their actions. All right, so what we've been talking about so far, those are known as one-shot games. It's a game that's only played one single time. All right, so that's a one-shot game. But how are things going to change if we play more than once? Well, then you can engage in strategic behaviors. This is where the firm attempts to influence future behaviors of the other firms. So they might not cheat, because if they cheat, the other firm is going to cheat, and then nobody makes money after that. So you're going to behave a little bit more strategically. So you have a couple strategies we'll discuss next. We have two. One is tit for tat. This is when you play cooperatively at first, and then you do whatever the other person did in the previous round. So if they cooperate, you keep cooperating. But if they cheat, then you cheat. So that's known as tit for tat. That's usually thought of as being the best strategy in multi-shot games. And there's also something known as tacit collusion. That's when firms limit their production and raise prices in such a way that raise each other's profits, but they don't make a formal agreement. So it's tacit, it's unspoken. So a gas station could do this by putting their prices up and letting the others just follow their prices. You see kind of a picture of that idea here. This has been a LaMoney production.